attacked him in the presence of everyone. Why did you do this? Why did you do this? The prophet wouldn't do that. He would say, what's wrong with so and so, without mentioning names. Again, the prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam narrated in a hadith that the strong man is not the one who can overpower others in wrestling. He said, power is not determined by wrestling people down. He said, rather the strong man is the one who controls himself when he is angry. Again, Anas bin Malik narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or Anas narrated that I was walking with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he was wearing a Najrani cloak. He said, I was in the company of Rasulullah. He was wearing a Najrani cloak. A Bedouin means an Arab. He came from nowhere, in the middle of nowhere. The Prophet don't know him. When he came, he sees roughly the edge of the cloak. In other words, he scolded the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When he scolded the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, I saw the marks left on his neck by the collar. Someone came from nowhere, scolded the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I said, I could see the mark. What did this man say? He said, the Bedouin ordered him to give him some of the wealth of Allah that he has. He just came, scolded the Prophet and said, give me from the money of Allah. Give me from the bank of the Muslims. Someone came from nowhere, attacked the Prophet, scolded him. He said, go to the Muslim bank account that has been gathered by people paying zakah and give me out of it. So what was the response of the Prophet? Someone who came and abused you, attacked you from nowhere. And he is wrong in every aspect. But what was his response? Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam turned to him and smiled. The man was still holding him. He turned to him and smiled. And after smiling, what did he do? He ordered that he should be given something. Give me from Baytul Mal. He looked at him, smiled and said, go with him and give him from Baytul Mal. No wonder Allah said to him, إِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَزِيمٍ. One of the scholars said, Allah created anger from fire. Allah created anger from fire and made it an instinct in man. Our natural instinct dictates that we should be angry when we are provoked. So Allah created anger from fire and made it an instinct in man. So what we respond to is determined by the type of attack that comes. So under normal circumstances, naturally, we are expected to be angry. No wonder there is a great reward for someone who restrains his anger when he is angry. When there is dispute, the flames of anger are fanned until a person's face and eyes became red. Everything is normal. But there is the dispute, and it's going on and on. All of a sudden, the eyes turn red. The face becomes what we are not used to. That's normal when we argue, when we are angry. And the eyes become red because the skin reflects what is underneath. What's in your heart is what's showing outside. I'm really angry. My eyes are red. I'm even shaking. I'm trembling. I'm ready to do anything, and I don't care what happens. Until afterwards, then I would realize I shouldn't have done this. But when I'm angry, I would just want to do things that are not right because I'm with Shaitan. Shaitan said, when you are angry, I am the one running in your veins. So everything turns, okay? Anger produces external and internal changes, such as change in color, trembling, uncontrolled actions, and a change in appearance. Such that if the angry person could see himself when he is angry, he would feel ashamed of his ugly appearance. If the angry person could see himself, he will be ashamed of himself. He will be ashamed of herself. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam regarded the one who controls himself when he is angry as being the strongest of all men. He said, "The strong man is the one who can is not the one who can wrestle, like I said, but the strong man is the person who can control himself when he is angry." Al-Hafiz Ibn Hajar, may Allah have mercy on him, he made some important points in Fathul Bari, in his commentary on the hadith wherein the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, La taghda. He said, the meaning of do not be angry is avoid the things that cause anger and do not expose yourself to that which provokes anger. When the Prophet said, La taghda, he commented on the hadith saying that means avoid everything that brings about anger and do not provoke anger. If I know that talking to you will make me angry, I shouldn't talk, even if I am right. Even if I am right. If I know trying to make a point will make me angry, I should stop, even if what I'm talking about makes sense. The only time I'm allowed to go ahead is if I can control my anger. If I know that going to that room, someone will anger me, or going to that gathering, or whatever occasion there is, I will meet someone who will make me feel angry, then avoid that which provokes anger. And don't say to an individual that you wouldn't like him to say unto you. Do unto others as you would like them to do unto you. So if you know that by telling him so and so, he might say something beyond what you have said and that provokes anger, then the translation of do not get angry means avoid it and do not provoke it. Aw kama qala alayhi salatu wassalam. Now, what are the effects of anger? When I'm angry, what effects does it have in me? What are the negative effects? The effects of anger can also be seen in people's action. Like I said, when they beat or abuse someone, someone can be angry and start beating people unnecessarily. Or even beating children without due care whether they're causing any harm. They don't care how to beat, where to beat, and when to beat. Why? Because they are controlled by their anger. You can see the effect on them. Or he turns his anger against himself, tearing his garments and slapping his cheeks. Sometimes he may have a seizure or fall unconscious, a break of vessels, or hit someone who has not done anything wrong. Sometimes you might be angry and beat people where they haven't done anything. Some people, due to anger, will even fall in unconscious. They would faint out of anger. So what benefit is there in being angry then? It's not helping me at all. If I'm angry with someone, I'm at the west part of the country and he's at the east, maybe he's having fun. He didn't even realize I'm angry. And I'm here struggling. I can't eat, I can't drink, and he's snoring. So what benefit there is in anger? Nothing. It doesn't work out for us. So as far as being angry is concerned, we should be selfish, we should be self-centered. Nothing and no one should make me angry. If you try to provoke it, I would leave you and avoid you. And if I'm okay, then I'll come back to you. But I will not dance to the tune of your actions. When you decide to anger me, I would make sure I avoid you as much as I can. Another effect of anger is the internal effects. The effects of anger could be seen in our actions, but you have internal and external ones. The internal effects are even worse because it generates hatreds in the heart, envy, hasad, and all types of bad feelings when people are angry. The most ugly effect of anger are the internal effects, and the external effects change as the result of the internal effects. When you are angry inside, it dictates what you do outside. Another issue is anger causes social problems. Example, there is always a problem in the matrimonial home. Someone can say to his wife, I've given you your divorce. I'm not interested in you anymore. And eventually when he is asked, he would say, I was under the influence of anger. Now that you have said that, you can't have your wife back. And vice versa. The wife might insist that, you know what, I want you to leave me alone. And she would do whatever it takes to go away. Eventually she will realize, you know what, this was the wrong decision. But sometimes you cannot turn the clock back. You might want your wife back, but you won't be able to have her. You might want your husband back, and you won't be able to have him. So when we are angry, we need to be careful as to how to react before it is too late. Another serious effect of anger is it damages our health. Very serious. It damages the health that results. The damage to health that results from anger can only be described by the doctors. There are so many health-related issues connected to anger, such as thrombosis, high blood pressure, abnormally rapid heartbeat could be caused by anger. And there's another one called hyperventilation. Hyperventilation is caused by anger. What that means is rapid, shallow breathing. Nijoka koli aibulu. Ngai fata munulo noki. Why is caused by anger? You might go to the doctor, and you might be diagnosed with that. You might be diagnosed by the doctor that you have hyperventilation. You're having difficulty in breathing. That is caused by anger. You're always angry. You're always angry. And it has added up. Now it's affecting you. If the angry person could see himself like that here in the mirror, when he's angry, he would hate himself and the way he looks. How happy would Shaitan be when he realizes that we are angry? Shaitan wins when we are angry. All of this has to do with anger for the sake of the worldly things. Many a times we are angry, it's all connected to dunya. The only anger that is accepted, anger is actually accepted. The only anger that is accepted is when we are angry for the sake of Allah. If our anger is geared to pleasing Allah, and that will not cause us harm. The Prophet said, "Man ra'a minkum munkaran falyughayyirhu biyadi." فَإِنْ لَمْ يَسْتَتِ فَبِلِسَانِ وَإِنْ لَمْ يَسْتَتِ فَبِقَلْبِ ذَلِكَ أَضْعَفُ الْإِيمَانِ. Whoever sees a forbidden thing being done, let him stop it with the use of his hand. That is more applicable with those who are the authorities. They have that power. The Prophet said, if you are not in the capacity to stop evil with your hand, then stop it with your mouth. Talk, enjoying good, and prevent evil with dignity, respect, be humble, and with wisdom. Then the Prophet said, if you cannot, at least consider it a vice. Do not be happy about it, but consider it a vice. Someone came, bullying someone, hitting someone, beating someone, abusing someone, insulting someone without any justification. That has angered me, rightly so. That's accepted in Islam. I am angry because you are bullying someone. I am angry because you are stealing something that belongs to everyone. I am angry with you because you are committing mischief on the face of this earth. I am angry with you because you are attacking the vulnerable for the sake of Allah. Sometimes people would do things out of anger. Even mentioning Allah's name, Allahu Akbar, when it's nothing to do with Allah, it's just anger. Many a times people will kill innocent people in the name of Allah and in the name of jihad. It has nothing to do with jihad. It's just personal anger. And Jahannam awaits them. How can you justify killing innocent people in the name of Allah? It has no connection with Islam. It's just a personal grudge. Whatever is causing you to kill people is anger. You are angry in this dunya and Jahannam awaits you. Because Allah causes death and gives life. Life belongs to Allah. You're not supposed to kill any innocent people. If you decide to do that, then Allah will punish you in this life and the life hereafter. That's why I said many a times, or throughout this our generation and generation that's gone past, anger is the result of every problem. People are dying because others are angry. And they try to connect that anger with Islam, and it has nothing to do with Islam. They're just killing innocent people because they have a cause that has nothing to do with Islam. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين من كل ذنب فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد الذي نصر الدين وأحب المساكين وكفل اليتيم وهدى إلى صراط المستقيم أما بعد What is the cure of anger? What is the solution to rid ourselves of being angry? Or when we are angry, what should we do to get away from this evil habit as soon as possible? Sulaiman ibn Shahab said, I was sitting with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and two men were slandering one another. Two men were slandering one another. They were arguing. One of them was red in the face, and the veins of his neck were standing out. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I know a word which if he were to say it, what he feels would go away. I know a word, if he were to say it right now, his red face would go away. He was there, he said, I know a word, if he says it, the anger will go. And that is, A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. The Prophet said, if he says this, the anger would go. Again, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam narrated in a hadith that if a man gets angry and says, I seek refuge with Allah, his anger will go away. If a man is angry and says, A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim, the anger will go away. Anger is part of human nature, like I said, and people vary in their anger. What makes you angry might not make the other angry. What makes you angry at 10 degrees might make another person at 1,000 degrees. So our angers vary. It may be difficult for a man not to get angry, but sincere people remember Allah and when they are reminded. There was a day a man provoked Omar radiallahu anhu, and everyone knows about Omar. Omar was angry and wanted to hit him. Another man came and recited a verse wherein Allah is telling us to control our anger. Omar sat back, gave up, forgive, forget, and overlook. So as believers, when the word of Allah is mentioned to us, when we are angry, we should take heed. But in the same vein, there was a hypocrite who was not like Omar. He was told about the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was arguing. Then the man said to him, seek refuge from Allah. Say, A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. And what was the response of the hypocrite? He said to the man who reminded him, do you think I'm crazy? Someone was arguing. The Muslim came and advised him and said, brother, say, A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim, so you can control your anger. He said to the man, do you think I'm crazy? Go away. And many a times, this is how we behave. When we are angry, no one can stop us. And this hadith is talking about a hypocrite. He was angry. He was saying what he had to say in a wrong way, out of anger. A man came and said, Ya Sheikh, say A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. He just related the hadith of the Prophet to him. The man said to him, the hypocrite said to him, who was arguing, do you think I'm crazy? Go away from me. Bonkoto. Ina hajinte. Dimbolema. Amudara pur defayo. Genatu umala. Do you think I'm crazy? Go away. This is the sign of the hypocrite. We don't want to be where the hypocrites will be on the day of Qiyamah. Inna al-munafiqina fi darkil asfali minan nar. Allah said the hypocrites, they will form the carpet of Jahannam. They will be at the lowest layer of Jahannam. The hypocrites are exposed everywhere in the Quran. And who are they? They try to show what's not in them. They pretend they are Muslims, they are not. They pretend they are good, they are not. They pretend to be positive when they are negative. Even during the time of the Prophet, you have hypocrites. Abdullah bin Ubayy bin Salul. Each time the Muslims were doing good, he would always come in and mess it all up. So it's been there from time immemorial, and it's still here. It's part of hypocrisy when you are arguing and people try to calm you down, and you even attack them instead. Go away. You think I'm crazy? Leave me alone. Another solution when we are angry is keep silence. Be quiet if you are angry. Don't say anything. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if any one of you becomes angry, let him keep silent. Again, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if anyone becomes angry, let him keep silent. This is because in most cases, the angry person loses self-control and could utter words of regret. I'm not in control. I would say things, and eventually would even come and say to the same person I was arguing it, I'm sorry, I was just angry, and I did mention what I wasn't meant to say. Prior to saying that, when you're angry, just keep quiet. Don't say anything. Another solution when we are angry to rid ourselves of anger is don't move. Stay still. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if any one of you becomes angry and he is standing, let him sit down, so his anger will go away. If it does not go away, let him lie down. The Prophet said, if anyone is angry, let him sit down. The anger will go away. If it doesn't go away, then let him lie down. It will go away. If it doesn't go away, perform wudu. Make dua. Restrain yourself. Abu Dharr, radiallahu anhu, was watering his animals at the trough when another man came. Let's assume this is this well belonged to Abu Dharr. He was watering his animals, giving them water to drink. Someone said, they even backbited him and said, you know what, let me go and provoke him and I will do the same. I would use his own water and water my own animals. The man came when Abu Dharr was doing that to provoke him. He started watering the same animals. What did Abu Dharr do? He sat down. He just sat down. In another narration, he just sat down and he lied down. Then someone asked him, Abu Dharr, why did you do this? This man came provoking you, your own place, your own sanctuary, your own well, your own tap. He's not allowed to come in. He's trespassing. So he came to do that. And you sat down. You were standing, you sat down. And eventually you lie down. He said, I was very angry when he did that. And the solution to my anger is to apply the sunnah and the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, that when you are angry, standing, sit down. If that doesn't work out, lie down. That's why I did that. And it worked for Abu Dharr. It will work for each and every one of us if we are doing it for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Another one is following the advice of the Prophet ﷺ. Like we said, he said to the man, do not be angry. The man keep asking him, Ya Rasulallah, advise me. He said, do not be angry, do not be angry. He keep repeating it, don't stop. Do not be angry and paradise will be yours. That's another hadith. Do not be angry and paradise will be yours. Another thing that helps us rid ourselves of anger is knowing the high status and advantages offered to those who control themselves. When we control ourselves at the time of anger, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guarantees us forgiveness, maghfirah, and eventually jannah, insha'Allah. And follow the example of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when you're angry. That's another one. And listening to the reminder as well helps. When you are reminded as to, this is what Allah says, this is what the Quran says, this is what the Prophet said, in anger management, heed that. You don't need to come and say, you know what, I'm going to a counselor, cancel me, I am angry all the time. How can I stop? You have been cancelled in the Quran and the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability to maintain our anger. And finally, the best way to control our anger all the time, make dua. Make dua. There is no pride or goodness in you taking pride, saying to people, when I get angry, it's not good. Who are you? You shouldn't take pride in that. You don't know me when I'm angry. When you are angry, you are weak. That's why Allah doesn't get angry. Because anger is weakness. Why are you taking pride in weakness? If I'm angry, I can do anything. Then you are a problem. اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافنا فيمن عافيت وتولنا فيمن توليت وبارك لنا فيما اعطيت وقنا واشرف عنا شر ما قضيت فانك تقضي ولا يقضى عليك انه لا يذل من واليت ولا يعز من عاديت تباركت ربنا وتعاليت نستغفرك من كل ذنب ونتوب اليك ونؤمن بك ونتوكل عليك ونثني عليك الخير كله يا من يجير ولا يجار عليه اجرنا من النار ومن خزي النار ومن كل عمل يقربنا إلى النار ودخلنا الجنة مع الأبرار يا عزيز يا جبار إنا نسألك رضاك والجنة ونعوذ بك من سخطك والنار إنا نسألك الجنة وما قرب إليها من قول وعمل ونعوذ بك من النار وما قرب إليها من قول وعمل الله لا إله إلا هو الحليم الكريم سبحان الله رب العرش العظيم والحمد لله رب العالمين نسألك موجبات رحمتك وعزائم مغفرتك والغنيمة من كل بر والسلامة من كل الليث من والفوز بالجنة والنجاة من النار. اللهم لا تدع لنا ذنبا إلا غفرته ولا هما إلا فرجته ولا دينا إلا قضيته ولا مريضا إلا شفيته ولا ميتا إلا رحمته ولا ضالا إلا هديته ولا مجاهدا إلا نصرته ولا أيبا إلا سترته ولا جاهلا إلا علمته ولا حاجة من هوائج الدنيا والآخرة لنا قرضا ولنا فيها صلاة إلا قضيتها برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين يا رب العالمين. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. ربنا اغفر لنا ولإخواننا الذين سبقونا بالإيمان ولا تجعل في قلوبنا غلا للذين آمنوا. ربنا إنك رؤوف رحيم. رب اغفر لي ولوالدي ولجميع المسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات برحمتك يا أول الأولين ويا آخر الآخرين يا ذو القوة المتين يا راحم المساكين يا أرحم الراحمين يا رب العالمين يا فعال لما يريد يا حنان يا منان يا بديع السماوات والأرض يا نعم المولى ويا نعم النصير يا من إذا أراد شيئا أن يقول له كن فيكون. تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم. تب علينا يا مولانا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. واغفر لنا وارحمنا إنك أنت الغفور الرحيم. إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. فاذكروني أذكركم واشكروا لي ولا تكفرون وأقم الصلاة.